capitalists. We're emerging from the economy of the Industrial Revolution, an economy confined to and limited by the Earth's physical resources, into the economy in mind, in which there are no bounds on human imagination, and the freedom to create is the most precious natural resource.
She thought something was unfair. He replied, "You're very cute. That's not fair. You're fairly well-to-do. That's very unfair. Most of all, you're American, which is really unfair. You better hope life never becomes fair." So said Patrick Jake O'Rourke to his young daughter after she complained about something being unfair. And folks, on today's show, we're doing Memorable Mentors, our tribute to the work of Patrick Jake O'Rourke, who died on the 15th of February at the age of 74. Hey, Ed, how's it going?
Hey, Ron, how you doing?
I've been marinating in PJ all day. Just amazing. Just amazing body of work.
Yeah, some great stuff. Some great stuff in there. And I look forward to this conversation. It's going to be fun, wide-ranging, as was PJ's work. Lots of different topics that he addressed. And I just think some fascinating stuff. Funny guy. But also, as Jonah Goldberg pointed out in his podcast, underrated with regard to his intellect. And I think that's the biggest thing that I've took away from working through this was not only was he funny, but he was also a freaking genius.
Unbelievable. I've been going through some of his work on economics and it just, you know, even events around the world, because, of course, he was the foreign correspondent for Rolling Stone. And I'm just amazed at his grasp of, you name it, everything. I mean, but the economics he was just brilliant at, and so funny, yet at the same time, like, fiendishly smart, but didn't wear it on his sleeve.
No, absolutely true. And was not at all trained in economics. In fact, that's one of the points of his book that he makes in Eat the Rich. I think it's in the introduction, which is one of the books that I concentrated on. He said, I knew nothing about this.
Yeah.
And so I figured I better go out and find something out about it.
He had a BA in English from the University of University of Miami in Ohio. He grew up in Toledo, Ohio, and he got a master's in English from John Hopkins. He was not economics, but he was self-taught in a lot of different areas, because his journalism just gave him a great bird's eye seat of the world and everything, and he incorporated that into his writing, and it's just amazing. I've counted, Ed, that he wrote 20 books.
Okay.
I've seen all sorts of different numbers, but I believe it's 20.
Okay.
And I've got 16 of them here.
Wikipedia page says 16. So
yeah, it's not right.
Not right.
It's not right. I can tell you it's not right. It's at least 20, and there could be more depending on whether or not you count some of his National Lampoon stuff. So I want to focus on his books, but I'm also curious, when did you encounter PJ for the first time?
I can't remember. I can't remember.
I can tell you it was in the early 90s, and it was probably either Rolling Stone or possibly National Review or some other magazine that he wrote for. Mm-hmm. You know, he was Car and Driver. He wrote for them. But I don't remember it. And the other thing, and I'm kind of freaked out that I don't think it's on your list. You know, we have a list of ultimate guests that we'd love to have on the show. We never talked about having PJ.
We didn't. Nope.
We could have gone after PJ. We probably could have got him.
Yeah.
We blew
true.
That.
Our miss.
I don't know why. I mean, I've been a fan of the guy for years. I got a whole shelf of his books. It's just, yeah. Wow. What a miss that was.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, which is one of the reasons why we had to try to right the wrong here and rectify it and talk about him today as a memorable mentor, because he really was in that way. Ron, I just want to fulfill an obligation and just mention that the show is sponsored by Sage, and that this is the Soul of Enterprise, and we welcome you to it. This is the first time that I can remember we've changed the opening. So that's how important this was to us. So thanks for doing that.
Yeah, for sure. 74, much too young to lose such a gifted, talented guy.
Isn't it funny, by the way, how 74 looks young now? Like when you were a kid, right? You would have thought 74. Oh my God,
that's ancient. He wrote a book, Ed, in 1998, and I'm sorry, 1983. I read it in 1992, and it's called Modern Manners, an etiquette book for rude people. And it's incredibly clever. It's got all sorts of quips. It's got things that you could not get away with today. Mm-hmm. He goes around the world and lists attributes of the people around the world in various countries that there's just no way mm-hmm. a publisher could get away with that. But I love this line. It's very bad form to screw your children, except in your will. And, you know, he was full of quips like that. I've been laughing all morning because he's just had these, like, they're like Rodney Dangerfield mm-hmm. one-liners, and you just crack up. But because they're profound, too.
Right.
They're not and just a joke. There's a truth embedded into it.
Right. And oftentimes after a bit of really important piece of an important piece of writing that he's done about the subject. And so, for example, this is from the On Wealth of Nations book. You know, barbarian leaders did not grab land in order to become rich. They were rich. This is but here's the great line afterwards. Shopping is easy and convenient when you do it with a large band of armed men.
Yeah, on the Wealth of Nations, that is absolutely profound book. He also wrote another one, Republican Party Reptile, in 1987. And this is the one that's got the famous Volga cruise story, his cruise that he took to Russia. Everybody says it's his other book, Holidays in Hell. That's not true. It's in this one.
Okay. So tell them the story.
Well, I would love to, except I didn't go back and reread it. Okay. But it is a profound story, because he's got insights about Russia and just it is a classic. In fact, it somewhat put him on the map. I think it broke him into a lot of different jobs with magazines and whatnot, because it was really an inspired piece of writing. I mean, Jonas talked about it, and all the different tributes I read, almost every one of them brings it up. So, but a couple of other quips from this book is, he says, I was attracted to the Volga Peace Cruise by a half-page advertisement in a February 27th, 1982 issue of The Nation magazine. It read in part, find out for yourself what's going on in the Soviet Union's capital and heartland as you join The Nation this summer on an exciting, affordable Soviet excursion. These were people who believed everything about the Soviet Union was perfect, but they were bringing their own toilet paper. That's brilliant. I mean, it's absolutely brilliant.
Yeah. Smart. And, you know, a little bit in honor of the situation that's going on in Russia right now, which we'll get to, I'm sure, in our bonus episode. You know, I think one of the insights that I've taken, it was good getting this beforehand and then being talked about in PJ's works, but the notion that the folks what was the most important thing to know about the Soviet Union? They were communist, right?
Yeah.
And they really did believe all of this stuff. And the fact that this tour existed at all is evidence of that.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. And, you know, the other thing that strikes me going back and reading his books is, you know, they don't age well in terms of you're reading things that are going on at the time that he wrote. But when you think about it in terms of his reading history, mm-hmm. it ages incredibly well. There is a ton of timeless wisdom, even when he's talking about a current topic that was going on in the early 90s or something.
Yeah. And that was, I think, especially true of Eat the Rich, because it does go, it is a tour, if you will, of different places. And he starts, of course, on Wall Street with what he calls, quote, good capitalism. The issue is that the Wall Street that he describes in this book, it's a great retrospective, as you said, because it doesn't exist anymore. You know, the Wall Street that he talks about in the mid to late 90s, that it was still the Wall Street of Barkers in the room making trades on a handshake or just hand signals, and
writing on those cards that Greg
writing
has.
On those cards right, that
right, right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And here's the crazy thing is that no longer exists. The New York Stock Exchange is basically now a television set.
Yeah, it's all digital.
Yep. So it's interesting, but you're right. From a historic perspective, it's still a fascinating piece of literature because it's a great description of what was actually going on at the time on Wall Street, and still, you know, to a certain extent, the point he's making is that in this chaos was incredible order.
Right. Right. Yeah. It's I guess it's my long way of saying that. This stuff is going to age well. His books, this body of work will age very well. Historians will pore through this mm-hmm. at some point. And, you know, it'll have something to say about the economic events and the political events of the time, the cultural events as well. And also the humor. Mm-hmm. You know, people make these comparisons to Hunter Thompson because of gonzo journalism. And, you know, PJ was a journalist. But the real comparisons are Mark Twain, Ambrose Pierce, you know, the satirists, the humorists of their day. That he's more in line with them.
Oh, H.L. Mencken, which he was the H.L. Mencken, yep. Mencken fellow at Cato. Let me finish this up, the concept on here, but just to give you a feel for this, and this is from Eat the Rich. And I love this notion of what the stock market really is. He says, we have an opinion. That opinion is a price. And since prices are constantly changing, our opinion is always about to be wrong. Think of the stock market as an endless Gallup poll with 207 billion things that people can't make up their minds about.
I know. I read that. It was great. And I'm sure you have it, too. And I've got it on my notes on the Wealth of Nations. But when he takes on the labor theory of value mm-hmm. versus the subjective theory of value, that's incredibly funny as well. He actually wrote a book called The Bachelor Home Companion also in 1987. I'm not sure how well these books did at the time, mm-hmm. but I think they set him up to a more prominent profile. I mean, he already had a high profile coming off of National Lampoon, and he went to Hollywood and made a lot of money. I think he wrote or had a hand in Easy Money, the Rodney Danger movie. Mm-hmm. And I think he did some other movie work. I'm not sure. Maybe it's on his Wikipedia page, but he certainly had a hand in Animal House. Mm-hmm. So he made a good living and then went back east because mm-hmm. he didn't like Los Angeles. And of course, he ended up buying a place out in New Hampshire, which is where he's been for, I don't know, a while, at least a decade or something, I think.
Right. Right. Well, we are up against our first break. I want to remind you that you can contact Ron or me by sending an email to asktsoe@verisage.com. Of course, for show notes as well as previews to upcoming shows, there is the website, thesoulofenterprise.com. And want to remind you that our show is sponsored by 90 Minds. That's our Patreon channel, I should say, patreon.com/TSOA. If you need a mind, get one at 90minds.com. But right now, a word from our sponsors.
Be sure to friend us on Facebook. You can do it right now. Visit facebook.com/voiceamerica or search for us at keyword Voice America.
Ron, let's take a minute and talk about our new sponsor, File, F-Y-L-E. We saw a demo of this thing, and it's really awesome.
It really is. It allows complete flexibility. You can use any program to submit your expenses. I found that completely liberating.
Yeah, and of course, it integrates with all of the accounting software out there.
Yeah, and they really nailed their pricing. They use a flat pricing system, so you don't pay for all your employees, only the ones that actually file their expense reports.
Yep, so check them out at filehq.com. That's FYLEHQ.com.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytic solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Have you ever read a book that changed your life? I sure have. Have you ever listened to an advertisement for a book so many times that you question the existence of God? Me too. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. I recorded the advertisement for Ron and Ed's book, The Soul of Enterprise, Dialogues on Blah 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 Whatever, and 4 years later, we're all tired of it, especially me. But thankfully, there's a solution. For just $10 a month, you never have to hear my voice again. For a commercial-free version of The Soul of Enterprise, go to patreon.com/TSOE and subscribe now.
Have you listened to so many of my ads that it's corroded your soul?
I absolutely have.
What if I told you that you could listen to my voice for an entire podcast?
I'd say that approximately half of the podcast is actually my voice.
Hello, I'm Greg Kite.
And I'm Caleb Newquist.
We're launching a new podcast called Oh My Fraud.
Ron and Ed explore the soul of enterprise.
Caleb and I explore fraud, which is more like the herpes of enterprise.
Go to wherever you get your podcasts and download
Oh My Fraud.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Kless. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
Well, welcome back, everybody. We're talking about P.J. O'Rourke and all of his work. And Ed, I've got his book here, Holidays in Hell, that he published in 1988. Now, I read this in 92, but he published this in 88, and he's talking about in this one chapter, Through Darkest America, Epcot Center. This is May 1983. This is outrageous. He says, every ride seems to begin with cavemen and end in a video game where a recorded voice asks you to face the challenges of tomorrow. He says, General Motors has something called the World of Motion that should be properly be titled Ride in the Wild Ironies. In the first place, they propel you through their robot show in a form of mass rail transit. And the tram cars are all too much like current GM automobiles, small, slow, and made out of plastic. Also, the ride keeps breaking or keeps coming to a halt, caught in some mid-exhibit traffic jam. And then he goes on to talk about the Kodak journey into the imagination. And then, of course, this is right after Epcot opened, so this is all, you know, kind of historical, but it's still funny. He says, I was desperate to get out of the place. He says, it was 20 degrees hotter inside than it was in the midday sun. He says, even a company with as little imagination as Kodak should know better than to have a greenhouse roof in Florida.
Well played.
It's so funny. And then he's got other great, great chapters in Holidays in Hell. It's a classic, classic book. It is.
Yeah.
Well worth reading.
Well, I just want to, would be remiss to not just give a couple of minutes to, I think, his most famous quote. I would consider his most famous quote, probably the one that I saw the most on his obits. I'm not sure what this is from, Ron. You might know, but it's this: giving money and power to government is like giving whiskey and car keys to teenage boys.
I want to say that's Parliament of Whores.
I would guess too.
But I didn't see it. And I know it appears somewhere else, but I didn't even note it because it is so well known. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure exactly what book it came out of. But I will give you something from Parliament of Whores, which is probably it's a profound book, and it has aged well, even though there's a lot of things that are, you know, no longer relevant. But like, here's a line: Republicans are the party that says government doesn't work, and then they get elected and prove it. And then he says, you know, one basic rule of business in life: when buying and selling are controlled by legislation, the first things to be bought and sold are legislators.
Our legislators, yeah.
I love that. I love that.
Yeah. And politicians are always interested in people. Not that this is always a virtue. Fleas are always interested in dogs.
Every government is a parliament of whores. The trouble is, in a democracy, the whores are us.
Mm-hmm.
That's the last line in the book. It's absolutely profound. There's a great long quote. I'm not going to read it at the start, but he's talking about the difference between God and Santa Claus. And he says, you know, he talks about God being, you know, holds people accountable. He's not sentimental, right? He holds a mortgage on literally everything in the world. He's difficult. He's unsentimental. He says, Santa Claus is another matter. He's cute. He's non-threatening. He's always cheerful, and he loves animals. He may know who's been naughty and who's been nice, but he never does anything about it. He gives everyone everything they want without thought of a quid pro quo. He works hard for charities, and he's famously generous to the poor. Santa Claus is preferable to God in every way but one. There is no such thing as Santa Claus. And he's saying that Republicans are God and Democrats are Santa Claus. That's how he sets that up. But it's very, very funny. Excellent book. Just, you know, this guy skewered both sides.
Mm-hmm.
Even though he did call himself a Republican, I've even got a line in here, the day that he says he turned conservative, which I want to get your reaction to, because he's hard to characterize. Mm-hmm. You want to say he's a libertarian, but there's a massive conservative streak through this guy. And I'll tell you, he's a hawk.
Mm-hmm.
And tell you that right now, if he was around today, he'd say, you know, we should be flying over.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we should engage. Maybe not with boots on the ground, but I'm sure he'd want to engage. With air power, probably. Even though he was a partisan, he did attack both sides. He really did, and skewered them.
Yeah,
beautifully, which is why he was liked on both sides of the political aisle. I mean, a lot of the and I read, I don't know, about 20 tributes, and a lot of them are from leftist journalists. They loved him, and they loved him not just as a writer. Everybody admired his talent as a writer, and there's a lot of tributes about that. But also, they admired him just as a person. He was great to be with. He could close down a bar. So he's a big drinker, you know, and he was just a very personable, amiable guy who didn't have any airs about him, even though he achieved this incredible notoriety and success.
Well, I think that part of his persona, too, the crumpled suit, the unkempt hair, that was just part of who he was. A grovelly speaking voice as well, probably grovelly from years of cigarette smoke that he did eventually stop. But he, like many of the others, started off his days as a student, as a leftist anti-war hippie.
Oh, yeah. And, do you have anything on that? Because I know he's written some things about that I found that I just thought were absolutely
nothing specific, but just, you know, that he did make this transformation over the course of time. It wasn't kind of an instantaneous thing. It was, as my understanding, a slow transformation. But as you said, he did have a specific moment where he's like, it's now that I fully understand it. So I don't know if you want to talk a little bit about that now.
I can't remember the book it's in, but I'll get to it. But he has an exchange with his grandmother about this very topic and is absolutely hysterical. He wrote another book that is Give War a Chance. And if you really want to see PJ's view of the world, this is a really good, and I mean like foreign policy, because he covered so many things around the world. It's like over 50 countries or something when he worked for Rolling Stone. You know, he did the first the first Iraq war. He covered that. But in this book, Give War a Chance, published in 1992, he says, it's impossible to get decent Chinese takeout in China. Cuban cigars are rationed in Cuba. And that's all you need to know about communism.
I wonder if the Chinese food thing is still the case in China, though. My guess is that it wouldn't be, but who knows?
Yeah, I'm not sure, especially because our idea of Chinese food as Americans is not.
I can tell you that from personal experience, just ordering Chinese food in Vancouver one time. I ordered a Chinese food from an authentic Chinese restaurant out in Vancouver, Canada. And I got to tell you, I got a soup with a chicken head in it. It was a chicken soup. It was a whole chicken in the soup, my friend.
Yeah, I can believe it. Oh, I remember the Christmas Story, when the family goes out to the Chinese meal for Christmas because, yeah, the neighbor's dog ate their turkey or whatever, and they bring him out a duck, and he says, well, it's smiling at me, and the guy pulls out his cleaver and that's all bad.
Yeah.
I got another book here that I really liked. I went through this one quite a lot this morning, and it's called All the Trouble in the World, which he wrote in 1994. And again, it's just a hodgepodge of topics, mostly economic, around the world. Like, I'll just pull out a random quote for you. Some kind of central planning seems to be the object of most environmental activists. But why is a Politburo expected to work better for plants and animals than it did for Russians? I mean, it's absolutely brilliant. He's also got one, Ed, that I know Russ Roberts would love this. He says, the first law of social science, the more precise the figure, the more general the lie.
Very true.
And then he's talking about, what Deirdre calls the great enrichment, but he says the countries that are most industrialized, and hence one would think most polluted, have the best morbidity, mortality, and income statistics. National well-being might almost be said to be a byproduct of pollution. So he talks a lot about the environment in here and takes on some of Al Gore's claims and Earth in the Balance and some other things, but it's just a really, really just a really well done thing. And I love this. And worrying is less work than doing something to fix the worry. This is especially true if we're careful to pick the biggest possible problems to worry about. Everybody wants to save the Earth. Nobody wants to help Mom do the dishes.
Very, very Jordan Peterson, right? Yeah, clean your room. Clean your room.
Make your bed. Yeah.
Clean your room. Yeah. So this is the quote I had on the environment. The collegiate idealists who fill the rank of the environmental movement seem willing to do absolutely anything to save the biosphere, except take science courses and learn something about it. Which I think is to some degree on point, although I will suggest that some folks have done a better job at that over the course of time. But Ron, we are up against another break already, and I want to remind you that you can contact Ron or me by sending that email to asktsoe@verisage.com. Of course, our show is sponsored by File. File gives you the ability to submit and spend on the go in bulk, or either through File's mobile app or everyday apps like the G Suite, Outlook, and Slack. Check them out at filehq.com. We enjoy their sponsorship and take a look at them. But right now, a word from our other sponsors.
Voice America is on your favorite smart speaker. If you have Alexa or Google Home, go ahead and give us a try.
Hey Alexa, play Finding Your Frequency podcast on TuneIn.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytic solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Have you ever listened to an online radio show that changed your life? I'm required to say that I have. Have you ever stopped listening to an online radio show because the commercials were mind-numbingly repetitive? Of course you haven't, because you're here right now. Look, you don't have to listen to me anymore. There's a commercial-free version of this show, and it only costs $10 a month. And for $15 a month, you get no commercials plus bonus content. Go to patreon.com/TSOE, subscribe now, and be free. You're worth it.
Ron, let's take a minute and talk about our new sponsor, File, F-Y-L-E. We saw a demo of this thing, and it's really awesome.
It really is. It allows complete flexibility. You can use any program to submit your expenses. I found that completely liberating.
Yeah, and of course, it integrates with all of the accounting software out there.
Yeah, and they really nailed their pricing. They use a flat pricing system, so you don't pay for all your employees, only the ones that actually file their expense reports.
Yep, so check them out at filehq.com. That's F-Y-L-E-H-Q.com.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Klass. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
And we are back with our P.J. O'Rourke retrospective, Memorable Mentors, with P.J. O'Rourke again. And Ron, I plugged this earlier, but I really want to plug once again P.J. O'Rourke's book, On the Wealth of Nations. Of course, the Adam Smith book is called The Wealth of Nations. And first of all, this is a funny introduction on why he added on to it. He says, this is like a real easy thing. I just throw on into it, on a famous book and walk my way through it in a humorous way. But he really does break it down and make it understandable to the point where you get a real good sense for the book Wealth of Nations by reading this humorous book. So here's a little quick take on this, and I just really love this line. He said, "And we were by no means finished with cheating out the nobility. We did the worst thing that can be done to fools. We gave them what they wanted." And yeah, you know, it's just stuff like that in the middle of reading his stuff about his understanding of the economy and what he learned from the Wealth of Nations. It just makes it eminently readable. It's a terrific little book.
It is. And, you know, Russ Roberts wrote a book on Adam Smith that does a really good job. He got into The Wealth of Nations, his first book, The Theory of Moral Sentiments. But you know what? So did PJ. PJ talked about his friends, David Hume, all the other people that influenced Smith. He called out where Smith got things wrong. You know, it was just it was a true piece of scholarship. And I think this is the point that, like, the guys on the Glop podcast were making about his books were serious political philosophy, like what Jonah writes, but with incredible humor interspersed in them. You know, which did make them, they're a treat to read. They really are, because I couldn't tell you how many times I was laughing this morning at various lines. I'll just give you another one. This was from his book, which is, and this is a great book, Don't Vote, It Just Encourages the Bastards, which he published in 2010. There's some great quips in here. He says, children, no child has ever written a letter to Santa Claus saying, please bring me and a bunch of kids I don't know a pony and we'll share. He's making the point that, you know, the basic decision unit of a society is the individual, right? There's no collective. It's a very libertarian point. He goes on to say, even within a family, because, you know, people say, well, but a family's more collective, it's more the socialist model. He said, yeah, but even within a family, you have to treat people as individuals.
Yeah, that notion is challenging, because this is Hayek, right? The notion of bringing the microcosm to the macrocosm, right, is a problem, and vice versa.
Yep.
Yep. So, I had a tendency to do this, and you'll still see posts on this. And I think that PJ took this apart in different places as well. You know, the thing that you'll say, well, if the federal budget were a family, this is what we'd be spending. Like, you can't do that.
Yeah.
It makes absolutely no sense.
You and I can't print money. We can't conjure money. There was a line somebody said about him that he said humor was more truth than factual. Which I thought was pretty profound if you think about that. But here's an example. He's talking about in this book, he talks about positive and negative rights, right? Mm-hmm. And he says, positive rights, we're confusing politics with Halloween. I mean, what a great way to explain it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah, they have to give me candy if I knock on their door and say trick or treat. Yeah, you know, it's a positive right.
Positive right. That always can. I still need to think about that when I hear about the difference between positive and negative rights. I still have to put myself in the zone. Okay, positive rights are the stuff on which we depend other people because positive is generally a positive word. Positive,
yeah, you don't want to say I have negative rights.
Right.
Yeah. The other thing, Ed, and this is great. You know, this kind of goes. And another guy I would compare him to would be Bastiat, because he's talking here about he doesn't mention Bastiat's quip about, well, if exports are good and imports are bad, then we should sink the ships at sea. Mm-hmm. Here's how PJ says it. He says imports are good, exports are bad. Imports are an income, exports are an expense. Imports are Christmas morning. Exports are January's visa bill.
Well played.
It's brilliant. So he's talking about being a college student. He says, I went home at Christmas break. He says, my grandmother said, Pat, I'm worried about you. Are you becoming a Democrat? Grandma, I said, Lyndon Johnson and Richard Nixon are both fascist pigs. Of course I'm not a Democrat. I'm a communist. And he was. He was a Maoist. He described himself as a Maoist. And she says, well, at least you're not a Democrat.
It's probably a true story, too, because I'm sure he got his wit partially from his parents and grandparents. So I don't doubt that that's probably true.
And then he writes this towards the end of this book, Ed. He says, but I was not yet a conservative. I was a Republican and a libertarian. The mutual exclusivity of those two political positions was, I thought, one more proof of the self-negating nature of politics. And then he says, I became a conservative at 11:59 p.m. on December 4th, 1997, the way many people become conservative. My wife gave birth. That's where he talks about his conservative streak. Certainly, I think conservatarian applies to him.
Yeah. Well, this is a bit off topic with regard to PJ, but I would be curious to see if this is something that he would have written about had he survived and continued to write the last couple of years. These terms are almost meaningless now. What does it mean to be a conservative now? Like,
I know
the notion of fiscal conservative. What does that even mean? That's like.
Yeah, I know. I'm not one of these guys that doesn't think labels are important, but you know, like we talk about a lot, words change,
mm-hmm.
right? Their use change, their meanings change in the culture. It was Hernando de Soto, and I can't remember. I saw this last week when I was prepping for the show, but he had a great line. Somebody was complaining to him about, I think it was the word liberal. You know, why'd we lose the word liberal as folks mm-hmm. on the right. He said, hey, don't die for a word.
Mm-hmm.
Don't die for a word.
Right.
You know, I think they were asking why do you use capitalism when you're in other countries? Because it's, you know, it's got all these negative connotations. He also
let me finish up one thing as we move on to from the government. This is one of my favorites, too. When a government controls both the economic power of individuals and the coercive power of the state, this violates the fundamental rule of happy living. Never let the people with all the money and the people with all the guns be the same people.
Yeah. There are so many lines like that. I can't even. He wrote a book, and this was one of the most hyper-partisan things, I think. It was the American Spectator's Enemies List. And I don't know, they put this out during the Clinton years, I think it was, and of course he compiled it. But he's got a lot of stinging lines in here. Here's one of them. He says, feminists who insist on ragging patriarchy by retaining upon marriage their daddy's names.
Which, yeah.
That's kind of interesting line. Mm-hmm. He says, if meat is murder, does that mean eggs are rape? he says, just to show you how partisan this was, because this is an enemies list. They were doing the whole Nixon, rip-off thing. He says, Hillary Rodham Clinton, of course we loathe her. Who are we to disagree with her own husband?
Ouch. Yeah. Well, but let's talk about that a little bit. I mean, his work here with the National Lampoon, which I just think there's an interesting story that kind of surrounds this. And this came out on the Jonah Goldberg podcast. And that is, why is it that National Lampoon has such a great brand, yet no, very few movies are released under National Lampoon.
Yeah, at least anymore, right?
Anymore, and it turns out that the reason for this is that when PJ, who was I think one of the founders of National Lampoon,
no, he was hired in later.
He was hired in later.
He became editor in like 78 or something. Yeah.
But he was part of the early days. But so I guess this goes back to the founder. They went to Harvard Lampoon to get permission to use the word Lampoon, which they didn't have to do because you can't copyright a title.
Right.
And I thought this is interesting that they went and did this anyway. And the agreement that they came up with is that the Harvard Lampoon gets 50% of any of the income that is made by National Lampoon. And it's a really, really strong brand, National Lampoon's Vacation, National Lampoon's the right is that you can't release a movies under it because you can't afford a flop.
Yeah, and Harvard Lampoon's brand was nowhere near as prominent as National Lampoon once Lampoon got going. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't even think Harvard Lampoon exists anymore.
No, it does, probably on the basis of the money they're getting from National Lampoon.
Yeah, maybe. I'm not sure. I thought somebody said it was extinct. I thought I read that.
Oh, okay.
But I could be wrong. In one of the tributes, somebody said, PJ wrote, the Chrysler chief executive Lee Iacocca, because PJ, that was another thing about him. He was a car guy. Mm-hmm. He wrote for Car and Driver. they wrote up a nice tribute about him. I guess Ferrari had contacted Car and Driver and said, hey, we've got a Ferrari in New York. We got to get out to a movie set in Los Angeles. You want to send a reporter to make the trip? And they sent PJ, probably a big mistake. But, and anyway, he's got a book about, driving like crazy, it's called. And it's just great. It's a bunch of car stories. But he wrote this. He said, Chrysler chief executive Lee Iacocca was a hero for our time, a conceited, big mouth, glad handing huckster who talked the government into loaning his company piles of money. And Iacocca, an autobiography, is literature for our time. That is, it stinks. Love it.
That was actually, I actually remember reading Iacocca, the book.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. No, it was awful. I couldn't stand it. I couldn't stand him. I'm still pissed off.
Told the Mustang story in there, though. So that's that there's some.
Yes, I got that out of there for sure.
So that's a plus. All right. Well, we're on our break. By the way, I did check around. The Harvard Lampoon is still around. So just we're clear on it. Yep, we're clear on that. But we're up against our last break. Want to remind you that you can rate our podcast by going to ratethispodcast.com/TSOE. And guess what? You can do there, folks, rate this podcast. So we really appreciate if you would go out and do that. Also want to remind you that you can get a hold of Ron or me by sending that email to asktsoe. Follow us on Twitter @asktsoe. But now a word from our sponsor and my employer, Sage.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytic solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Ron, let's take a minute and talk about our new sponsor, File, F-Y-L-E. We saw a demo of this thing, and it's really awesome.
It really is. It allows complete flexibility. You can use any program to submit your expenses. I found that completely liberating.
Yeah, and of course, it integrates with all of the accounting software out there.
Yeah, and they really nailed their pricing. They use a flat pricing system, so you don't pay for all your employees, only the ones that actually file their expense reports.
Yep, so check them out at filehq.com. That's F-Y-L-E-H-Q.com.
Have you ever been so annoyed by a commercial for a $5 ebook that you were willing to pay $10 to never hear it again? I sure have. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. Over the last several years, you've come to hate me, and I hate me too. By now, you know that for $5, you can get a copy of Ron and Ed's book. What you might not know is for twice that much every month for forever, you can stop hearing me plug Ron and Ed's book, which totally makes sense, like the Diamond Water Paradox. Go to patreon.com/TSOE and subscribe today. Please, for the love of God, make it stop!
Have you listened to so many of my ads that it's corroded your soul?
I absolutely have.
What if I told you that you could listen to my voice for an entire podcast?
I'd say that approximately half of the podcast is actually my voice.
Hello, I'm Greg Kite.
And I'm Caleb Newquist.
We're launching a new podcast called Oh My Fraud.
Ron and Ed explore the soul of enterprise.
Caleb and I explore fraud, which is more like the herpes of enterprise.
Go to wherever you get your podcasts and download
Oh My Fraud.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Kless. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
Well, welcome back, everybody. We're talking about PJ O'Rourke and Ed again from this book, Age and Guile Beat Youth, Innocence and a Bad Haircut. He's talking about Bill Clinton. He says Bill Clinton hates them and fears them, especially the Cubans. Bill knows the Cubans are crazy. Only crazy people would flee from a country with free medical care, guaranteed employment for life, and first-rate gun control. And then he's talking about different sports. He's talking about fly fishing, and we know some folks who fly fish. He says, furthermore, it's conducted in the middle of the back fly season, cast and swat. Fly fishing may be a sport invented by insects with fly fishermen as bait. And what does the truly sophisticated dry fly artist do when he finally bags a fish? He lets the full thing go and eats bologna sandwiches instead.
Good stuff. Well, I just wanted to share this one anecdote, Ron, from David Bowes's tribute of PJ O'Rourke that was written on the 15th of February. I just thought that this was a real good insight. He said, a few years ago, I had the idea to give a young colleague for Christmas a postgraduate course in political science and economics, PJ's books, Parliament of Whores and Eat the Rich. So I went to my local Barnes & Noble to search for them. They weren't in current affairs, not in economics. No separate section called politics. So I decided to try Borders, then the largest bookstore around. But first, and yet to avoid more driving around, I went online to see if my Borders had them in stock. Sure enough, they did. Checking to see where on the store I would find them, I discovered that they were under a shelf called Humorous Writing. Oh, right, I thought. They're not books on economics or current affairs. They're humor.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, like Jonah Goldberg said, he kind of looked at PJ's career as kind of a warning that because he didn't think he had the humor writing talent of PJ. And but if you get categorized that way, you know, then people are, every book, everything you read, they're going to expect to be laughing. And if they don't laugh, it's they're going to consider it not good.
Yeah.
You know, because PJ did write some things. I think Jonah talked about this, that that weren't. That were serious. That had there were no quips. There were no jokes, and they didn't do very well. Probably would be my guess because you pick up BJ to laugh.
Well, I think we talked about this with regard to some other things on our bonus episode, or maybe it was just in a private conversation. But you know, I think there's in a way, guys like PJ get dismissed under this. Well, he's just being funny. It's right. and it's easy to be like it's easy to be funny all the time. It's like what is wrong with? Well, he was just writing. He wasn't writing for real academics because he was funny. Like, well, what's wrong? What are you kidding me? It's much harder to write an academic work like on Wealth of Nations than it is to do something that has humor than it is to just write an academic paper on it.
Right. Absolutely. I mean, just think about it. How many stand-up comedians are there, and how many comedic writers are there? Compare the two. It's a handful of comedic writers, literally. I mean living or I would say that you read regularly. I mean, name the comedic writers that you read on a regular basis.
Dave Barry.
That's the one that comes up. PJ, yeah, PJ. Of course came up. I would add Florence King, but nobody knows her unless you're just a, you know, wacko National Review fan.
Irma
but,
Bombach. Remember Irma Bombach?
Yeah, Florence King put, in fact, Irma Bombach plagiarized from Florence King. And Florence King.
Oh, really?
Florence King was amazing. Probably funnier than PJ. I think PJ really admired Florence King. Most of the humor writers do. They know of her. She's brilliant. But the point is, we can sit here and name hundreds of authors that we admire, but how many humor? I mean, Mark Twain, obviously. If you go back to history, sure. PJ,
H.L. Mencken, blah blah blah.
So. He's talking about cars in his book, Driving Like Crazy. He says, our new car, he's talking about, you know, after he had kids, our new car had to be big because although babies themselves are surprisingly small, their car seats, strollers, collapsible cribs, etc., are all built to accommodate late career Marlon Brando. Then he says, but pity the poor American car when Congress and the White House get through with it. A lightweight vehicle with a small carbon footprint using alternative energy and renewable resources to operate in a sustainable way. When I was a kid, we called it a Schwinn.
I love my Schwinn bicycle, Ron.
I did too, with the banana seat.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Gotta have the banana seat, you know? So.
Another thing, Ed, that somebody, and this was probably the best tribute write-up came from, I thought, Matt Labash. And I don't even know who Matt Labash is, journalist, but he said, good writers make you want to read, but great writers make you want to write. And that's what he said about PJ. I've never heard that. That's a great expression. That's a great thought. It's really true.
That's a fascinating expression. Yeah. Like that a lot.
I do too. Yeah. I really like that. What else you got? Did you pick up on anything else? These tributes just you talked about. Even Acton gave him a tribute, how he emceed one of their events.
Their events, yeah.
And
yeah,
closed the bar.
Yeah, of course. He would always close the bar. But I think it just had a great way of turning a phrase. And even stuff that you would normally think of, I understand that. But, for example, his your money does not cause my poverty. Yes. Refuse to believe this at the bottom is at the bottom of most bad economic thinking. And that is just terrific line. Yes, funny, but also incredibly insightful and something that we've repeated over and over on this. This is the inverse of the Israel test, right? The good fortune of others is also one's own. Your wealth doesn't cause my poverty. And far too many people don't believe that.
And his line at about, you know, if it, the economy is not a pizza, that is, if I eat more, you have to, you're stuck eating the box.
Mm-hmm.
It, you know, like Halloween being a positive, right? I mean, that's a real creative brain, you know, that is making those connections.
It's funny you should bring this up. There was a meme that was posted by one of my friends who's a teacher, and she says this happened to be from a student of hers that her mother showed her from the previous school she was in. She's a private school teacher, and it was a question that was on the math test that said, it was something like, if somebody eats 3/5 of the pizza and somebody eats 4/6 of the pizza, how is it that someone eating the 4/6 of the pizza could be eating more? And the kid responded, well, because the one pizza is bigger. And the teacher says, no, that's not correct. 4/5 is always greater than 2/3. It's like, not if the pie's bigger. Not if the, and I don't think that, I think that's what people get stuck on, is that the pie is not a finite size. The pie grows.
Right, right. He's got a thing in here about, he's talking about the great enrichment, just the explosion of wealth. And mm-hmm. he says, you know, he says, the modern economy works and we know how to make it better. Free markets are extremely successful. What we have to do is learn to live or learn to love wealth creation.
Mm-hmm. And
the only known antidote to poverty. So anyway, wow, so much more to say on him, but I'd recommend any of his books, really.
Oh, yeah.
That's our tribute to PJ. Lost him way too soon, but boy, what a great talent. Ed, what do we have coming up next week?
Next week, Ron, we are going to have back with us for the, I believe, fifth time, a record-setting fifth time on the Soul of Enterprise, our friend and Verisage colleague, Reginald Thomas Lee, who's going to talk about his new book, Project Profitability.
Awesome. I will see you in 167 hours. This has been the Soul of Enterprise, Business in the Knowledge Economy, sponsored by Sage, transforming the way people think and work so their organizations can thrive. Join us next week, folks, on Friday at noon Pacific time. In the meantime, check us out at thesoulofenterprise.com. We'll post full show notes of our discussion today. And also, you can contact me or Ed at asktsoe@verisage.com. Thanks for listening, folks. Have a great weekend.